Hey everybody, Tom here with Hidden Beats, and today we are talking with Garrett Neiles again. How are you doing, sir?
Very good, very good. How are you doing, Tom?
Yeah, it's nice relaxing day. I just got off of a 10-day music festival stint where I was there every day covering stuff. So
Right on, right
nice
on.
to sit down and relax now.
Where was that?
Right here in Ottawa, actually, we had Blues Fest that was going on.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful. Who was the standout?
We had Jelly Roll actually pop in, so that was kind of the big ticket that nobody expected, and they added a whole new day to the festival for just him actually.
Oh, no way, no
Yeah.
way. He's popping off in the last couple of years. What was he? He was best new artist, his oldest artist to win best new artist last year, was it?
Yeah, he's all over the place with winning these awards and everything, and they brought him in to do like an awards thing too with the Ottawa Mental Health clinic or whatever it's called here.
Cool,
So
cool.
there's some fun stuff with that. Well, you know the drill. We're here to talk about you, about your music and all the fun things that you do. But for
Yeah.
those who are new, can we get a little intro about yourself?
Yeah, my name's Garrett Neiles. I'm born and raised in Winnipeg, Manitoba. Currently living out here in Toronto. I am a pop rock artist, and I just started my release of basically leading up to a new album coming out in 2025. So I've been releasing singles for the 2024 campaign so far. We just dropped a single last month called Lipstick. And yeah, we're very excited about what this summer has held and a couple things that we have slated coming up here. So yeah, that's a start.
So last time we talked was I think 8 or 9 months ago at this point. And how has Toronto been treating you so far? You've been there for a little bit now.
Yeah, been here for just over a year now. So Toronto's been great. I love the energy and the pace of the city here. And I've seemed to really find a good community here to work with both from a musicianship standpoint as well as just a general creative standpoint.
Has there been any kind of really unique things you've come across once you've been getting into the community?
Unique.
I mean, coming from Winnipeg, it's a different style compared to Toronto, so there's probably lots of different stuff that's been popping up.
That's a great question. I think the two cities contrast a little bit in terms of Winnipeg's very you find that you have these groups or these communities of musicians that have been doing stuff together for a long time, and it's great in terms of being able to find larger kind of packs of people. Out here in Toronto, there seems to be more of that lone wolf type of working style, and then you'll have your smaller kind of satellite groups. I work with a pretty tight core out here, a producer, a songwriting partner, mixer and master, and then my girlfriend is also a musician and a songwriter, so we do a lot of stuff together, and we keep it tight. Like that's our band, that's our production and mixing process people, and yeah, it's kind of it's a nice little nucleus that we got going on.
What's some of the your favorite parts about starting to get involved in all the different community stuff?
Favorite parts? I get energized when I connect with other people, and when I'm allowed to express myself freely in a safe space per se. And it sounds like an interesting concept, but I'm somebody that, unless I really know you and trust you, you're probably not gonna get the full Garrett from me. It takes a while for me to really, find that trust with somebody, and I really do believe that that's where the greatest art lies is when you are able to express yourself freely. But to me, just the way that I go about things, I like to you know, vet the people that I work with first, and make sure that it's a good fit, and make sure that this is somebody that, you know, I want to be, you know, pursuing past where, you know, the surface level is. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Having those solid people around you definitely makes the whole process that much better.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's definitely been one of the more interesting endeavors out here in a new city. I think that, you know, a city like Winnipeg, especially growing up and living there for 20 some odd years, you really get an idea. You get an idea of who your core group is. Whereas when you're in a big city like Toronto, you kind of got to go out there and make some mistakes and, you know, first date a lot of people, and find out, you know, what are the characteristics of the people that you want to be working with, and then what are some of the red flags that you want to try and, you know, avoid.
Yeah. How has your music, do you think, been like the reception for your style of music and just what you do been in the city right now?
I think it's been good so far.
Yeah.
Just played a big show at North by Northeast at Supermarket, which is one of the premier indie artist venues in Toronto, and we had a great reception to that. We got a music video coming out in a couple weeks from that, so very excited to relive as well as broadcast a little bit of the energy with the show and you know, create that buzz around the city. So it's been good. You know, I think as artists we toy the line a little bit between creative freedom and then also, okay, what is going to, you know, develop some buzz and demand around what we're doing. Now, you know, you're always going to have the outliers like the Rick Rubins of the world that say, well, you can't focus on what the people want. It's got to be a reflection of, you know, how you're feeling and an exact, you know, postage stamp on the moment of where you're at in life. And I agree with that to an extent. You know, I think that your sound and your song should be reflective of what is, you know, what you're feeling and what really is landing with you. But then you got to figure out a way, okay, how do I market this to who I perceive as my audience, and, you know, how are they going to accept that and receive that? You know, I think I've been guilty of maybe force feeding music to an audience before without allowing them to decide, is this something that's for me? And so I think becoming a little bit more inviting and allowing the audience to receive it has been, you know, my goal right now, especially here in Toronto. So I think that, you know, it's continuing to harness the songwriting, continuing to harness the craft, and, you know, developing my voice and skills, and, you know, let's welcome people to want to listen to it and be excited about the live show and everything that comes with it.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk a little bit about Lipstick. What was the process behind putting that together, and how has that been going for you so far?
Yeah, so Lipstick came together from a songwriting session. So like I said, I've got a core group here that I've been working with. They've actually branded themselves as Play the Jukebox, and it's a producer, a writing partner, and a mixing mastering engineer that I've been working with. And the song Lipstick came from a songwriting session that we did together, and it was definitely one of the more uplifting, joyous experiences that I've had with songwriting, and then obviously the final product reflected that as well. And it was an interesting session. It started out with, I've always been kind of a top liner during the writing session, focusing on the melodies, the hooks, you know, the actual, more so the ear candy of the song. And our writing partner Anwar is very, very strong with words and articulating a message And then John, the producer, is kind of the omniscient figure that sits above both of us and just, you know, he knows when to participate, but he's seeing the master plan unfold for the production and the composition itself. So the sessions almost always start with John and I just kind of jamming on different melodies, different chord progressions. I'm usually on acoustic guitar, John's generally on piano. And, you know, we'll jam some ideas and I'll scat some lyrics about stuff that's prevalent in my life right now. And, you know, we usually break off into a little bit of a conversation with Anwar about some of these ideas that I'm having and where I want to go with the idea. And the particular theme for this song was I wanted to write about when I watch my girlfriend get ready for a night out, she feels so powerful doing her lipstick in the mirror, doing her makeup, getting all dolled up for the night out. And I was kind of like recounting that moment in my head of her just, you know, really feeling powerful and in her body. And I wanted to capture that because I thought that how do we uplift people? What makes them feel sexy? What makes them feel, you know, like their best self? And for me, it was this moment and watching her, you know, put on her favorite clothes, try on different outfits, and then finally land on the right one, even though she looks great in all of them. But so this song came from that. And, you know, we're kind of jamming on different chords, going back and forth on melodies. And, you know, we write in a Google Doc and all of a sudden I start seeing words appear and Anwar is writing the words lipstick and, you know, and we just kind of tangent on and branch off from there. And, you know, 2 hours later, we have a full song written and, you know, largely in part to Anwar being able to decipher what I have going on in here and what I'm, you know, conveying with my emotion and you know, ideas through the melody and whatever we're jamming on.
Mm-hmm. I was going to ask like where the inspiration came from, because I was wondering, were you sitting there trying lipstick on to see if this worked yourself? Like how that all came about, but because it has a very much, like you said, that empowerment almost like putting your lipstick on, you're invincible, things like that. And
yeah, it's a metaphor for, you know, when whatever it is that person or that individual does that makes them feel powerful, right? And mm-hmm. you know, in this case, it was we took it from a literal instance where, you know, my partner was putting on her lipstick, and but to me it embodies so much more. I mean, for me, I feel the feeling when I get on stage and, you know, I'm performing, like that's me putting on my lipstick. I feel invincible on stage. And, you know, for somebody else that could be, you know, interviewing people and helping share their story, you know, you feel after you do that, you know, that's a very powerful thing and you've helped an artist in their life. So mm-hmm. it's, you know, it's supposed to be one of those songs that really has a universal meaning, but a particular concept.
Yeah, and you can feel it right away. Like I was looking through reading the lyrics as it was playing and kind of picturing what it could mean, but then also like you said, it has a universal concept to it where it doesn't have to be just lipstick, but something that makes you feel that little bit extra in yourself, really.
Yeah, it's a pretty, I'm very pleased with how this one turned out. And I think that just all the minute details to the song, you know, in the second verse, it's a frame, the way that it's framed, it's all about the other person, you know, on your way to work, on my face when you're walking out the door. It's just about empowering the subject that you're speaking to, or mm-hmm. the listener if they're listening to it. And I think that was really important, to not try and, you know, make the song about us and us looking cool. And I think that it's something that I've probably been guilty of for the bulk of my songwriting career is, you know, writing songs for me and how I feel. And I think that most artists, you know, that is our anchoring point, is we want to write about, you know, our experiences. But then how do you turn those experiences and make that for somebody else, I guess, is the golden question, right? And I feel like we did a really, really good job of that in this song. It really feels like we're gifting or, you know, allowing the listener to feel empowered by this song.
Yeah, it's, you're telling a different story, really. And it's nice to see, because someone like myself is, I can almost picture a music video behind that and how that would work out. Like there's so many different things that song evokes emotionally that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So how do you think this one has evolved? So last time we talked, it was about Outgrow and the upcoming EP release. So how do you think this one's evolved from back in that process?
Yeah, well, Outgrow was one of the first songs actually that I'd say one of the first songs that I wrote with actual intention of releasing music, we'll put it that way. Mm-hmm. So Outgrow is it stretches a while back. So we've definitely grown as writers since then, and just grown as individuals since then, which I think is one of the more important facets of writing is continuing to mature and grow as a human being, right? It's you know, writing, it comes down to, you know, having a keen awareness for these experiences and moments that you have and what they mean to you and what they mean to other people. So you know, for example, in Outgrow, I was, you know, recounting the emotions I felt from a relationship falling apart that was really not a relationship. It, you know, it was more of a juvenile experience, I think, that's not to downplay the feelings that were involved, but that didn't really have the substance that would make, a healthy relationship. And, you know, I think that that just reflects where I was at in that point of life. So the biggest thing has just been growth as an individual, understanding what, you know, things that I want out of my life and how to get those and surround myself with that and those types of people that also convey that.
Mm-hmm. So out of all this growth, what do you think is the most interesting thing you've learned about yourself?
The most interesting thing I've learned about myself. I think that I've really, you know, I didn't realize how much of a people pleasing type that I was. And I really think that I was able to kind of be a semi chameleon with a lot of different groups of people. And really fit in and just kind of conform to those different groups. And I think that the most interesting part of this growth has been not fitting in with all sorts of different kinds of groups and really understanding, you know, what kind of values that I stand for and that I possess, and then also attracting those types of people into my life and maybe not maintaining some relationships that don't also share that. So there's been lots of different things. And I do believe that, you know, moving to a new city where you have that space and time and you're almost forced to go internal and find out more about yourself has been a really healthy experience for me. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I could go on and on about this stuff all day, but.
Well, that's it. It's all growth and it's all learning. So there's always something to talk about, I think, at that point.
Yeah. I believe that, you know, it's just exciting to see what you can unlock within yourself as a human being. I think it's always there. Like, you don't have to go out and grab something from the universe and then add it to you. It's already there.
Yeah.
You just have to unlock it and discover it. Like, you know, if you want to become, I don't know, a president of your organization, and you're at a certain level, well, you know, if that's truly what you desire, you already have the tools to do that. You just have to discover them within and find that self-belief. You know, that might be, you know, taking some courses in leadership or reading some books or whatnot, but all of that, all of the tools, the actual tools that you need to be in that position, you already possess them. You just have to find them within.
I think we lose that as we get older. So, like, I watch my daughter, she's almost 2 now, and she's learning all these things, and the problem solving that she goes through to just get to the next level of whatever she's trying to do seems so fluid with her. But then as you get older, you forget that you can problem solve if you just take a moment and think about it, and life just makes that a little bit more difficult.
Well, think about somebody that, you know, is going through a period where they're heightened stress, you know, maybe even label it anxiety, or they're suffering performance anxiety out of some sort of notion that's going on in their life. Think back to when they were a child. Like, you know, for example, your 2-year-old daughter, you watch her, she probably doesn't move around with a lot of fear of what's going to come next, or she doesn't have the tension in her shoulders of, you know, the stress burdening her from work. So, you know, at some point in our life, we were all pretty free spirits without a ton of anxiety or a ton of stress. And so it's about finding ways, how do we allow that true self to come through, right? And it's not easy. It's not easy for sure. And, you know, are you ever going to be perfect? Is it ever going to be carefree forever? No, I don't think so. I don't think that that's a good way to live either. But finding that good equilibrium, and understanding that you do possess, you know, that inner peace, and you just have to figure out how to access it. I think that that's extremely important, and, you know, a valuable learning lesson to learn as a young adult or a, you know, developed adult at any time in life.
Mm-hmm. I think there was this thing I read once that said, once you hit 40, you start to lose you have more of the I don't give a fuck mentality. So you don't have some of that anxiety about things. So maybe we all just have to hunker down and keep wait until we hit 40 before that comes in.
Yeah. And, you know, like I'd say that I, as an artist, especially, you know, you're at a heightened, you know, there's just lots of opportunity to compare yourself and feel like you're falling behind your peers, just because we're always publicly broadcasting our work or our accomplishments, or, you know, the festivals we just secured, or, you know, the release we dropped that just got 100,000 streams. And it's very easy to feel like you're not worthy, or you're falling behind, or why can't I have that? And I think that, you know, social media, you're always going to have that immediate thought when you see stuff like that. And it's very hard to not have those first thoughts. But I'm a big believer that your first thought isn't always really controllable, but your second thought is.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm really, really working to make sure that, you know, let's get back to what is my actual belief, or what is my, you know, actual frame of mind when I feel these types of feelings of comparison, or like, damn, like, why is this not working? Why is this not getting, you know, catching fire here? You know, it takes me a couple minutes, but I really try and reframe, like, okay, did I do everything that I could in that process in making that song or that video or whatever it is? Okay, I did everything that I could have, and I'm satisfied with the process. I love the song and I love everything about it. Well, then there's really not much else you can do, right? You know, maybe you tinker your your method and delivery or marketing it. But I mean, it's such a crapshoot. Like,
yeah,
so I'm really trying to, I'm trying to refine everything to process goals. Like, am I taking the time to create engaging captions, or am I just posting stuff and trying to, you know, throw shit at the wall and see what sticks?
Yeah.
I'm actually taking the time and putting, you know, what I believe to be the true reflection of Garrett into these pieces, then I don't really have control over whether, you know, the universe loves it or not.
Yeah.
I love it. And I want to attract other people that I don't want the whole world to love these things. I want the people that actually do love them to come to it. So in that sense, trying to find more of me in my own art and how I'm articulating myself in the media is important, because I want to find other people that are actually attracted to that
yeah.
art there.
Well, I mean, hey, I'm having fun with your music, so that's I think that's a pretty good sign right there.
Awesome. Well, I'm glad to hear that. It's, you know, it's been a lot of work and a long couple of years here, you know, just finding that space of, mm-hmm. okay, here's my people. And here's the people that are really engaging with the music. So to hear that you're liking it and having fun with it, that's I appreciate that. I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah, and I love the fact that you can go through your catalog and you can see the different kind of places you were in. You have some more ballady stuff. You have some more like Lipstick being more kind of uplifting, fun. Mm-hmm. There's a lot there, so it leaves a lot of open doors for you to explore and do different things with it.
Yeah. Well, like I'm glad that you bring that up, because again, it goes back to, you know, I really think that the art reflects my state of life.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting. I've got more going on than I've ever had in my life. Yet I feel this calmness, this capability almost.
You're able just to handle it.
Yeah, that I'm able to handle it. And I almost describe it as like, I almost always felt like a little boy, but now I feel like an adult. Mm-hmm. If that makes sense to you, like, even though, you know, I'm 31 years old now, so I'm obviously not a kid anymore. I think I've always felt like a kid, and like I needed that hand to hold to a certain extent. And you know, I think that I wonder if everybody else has gone through that experience where they feel like they've let go of that hand and that they understand that it's time to start being the hand for somebody else to eventually hold. And I actually, that was, we had a writing session last weekend, and that was the topic of it, was writing a song about becoming the person I want to be to eventually, you know, have a child or
yeah.
have kids and be able to, you know, be able to not fuck it up. So.
Yeah. I think so with kind of that experience in mind, I think most people have those when you're growing up. Like, I know I have actually probably had something similar happen, especially when having a child. You have to, you can't hold someone else's hand because someone else is holding yours now, and you have to be, it's like the responsibility switch kicks on a little bit more, that you have to make sure you're taking care of everything now. And,
yeah.
and it almost becomes easier. Like, I found the similar thing, like there's a lot going on, but I'm actually able to manage things pretty good. And it's almost smooth, really. It makes it a little bit more interesting that way.
Yeah. What would you say, like, and you know, it's a personal question, but how would you say that your stress management and overall inner peace, how do you feel in your life right now?
Right now, I mean, there's so much going on, like festivals, everything, with all the stuff going on, job, kid. I have another kid on the way.
Oh, congrats.
Yeah, so little boy due in October, so we're trying to manage all that stuff. But I'm almost at a point where it's not stress anymore. It's just a checklist of I have to make sure I get all these things done, but I know I can get it done. I just have to manage myself. And life's going pretty good, really, for what everything's going on right now, even though some of it's hectic, some of it's just insane all the time, but it's not bad.
Yeah, and it's a little bit about taming the wild, I'd say, you know, and just understanding that there's gonna be chaos, and you know, you look around what's going on in the world right now, and you know, you gotta equip yourself with that ability to kind of walk through and continue on despite just the uncertainty and not really knowing that you're gonna have that safety net or that comfort and understanding that you're gonna have to survive regardless. It's a lot for sure.
Life clicks in at some point and just kind of like it's your brain almost goes, okay, I can work with this. And it's not like you were younger and going, oh my God, when is something gonna happen? It's like it will happen just when it happens.
Well, and I think that's having a little faith in whatever you believe in, whether it's a higher power or a religion. I think that just having faith that you're on the right course and that life is going to work out for you instead of against you. I think that's, you know, a really important part to inner peace is just understanding that, hey, this is what needs to happen. And, you know, whether it's a perceivably good thing or a bad thing, you're either going to learn from it or you're going to, you know, grow because of it. Right. So.
Well, you learn from them no matter what, even if you don't want to learn from them, there's always something you have to take away from.
I feel like that's been a huge thing for me lately. It's just the lesson learning and taking, you know, taking the blinders of naivete off my eyes a little bit. You know, unfortunately, you can't trust everybody in the world and you can't give everything to everybody in the world because it's not palatable. You can't do that, right? And I think when you make that realization, it really helps you narrow down, okay, what are the characteristics of somebody that I can trust and keep close through this journey. So
yeah, no, you're not wrong. That's definitely that big part.
Yeah.
But we have a little bit more time left. Let's knock out some fun questions.
Yeah.
Some very thoughtful ones. My favorite one, and I actually don't think I asked you this one last time. I was looking through my notes, is what's one thing you think should be asked more in an interview that's not asked enough?
One thing that I think should be asked in an interview is, what is your favorite clothing brand? I'm a big clothing guy.
Okay. Yeah. That's a nice.
I know you do merch as well too.
Mm-hmm. I'll have to send you some and get you repping some stuff up there.
I'd love it. Yeah. I'm a big fashion guy. And I think that a lot of other artists are as well. So what your favorite clothing brand and what the latest that you've been wearing is a cool question to me.
Okay. I'm going to note that one down because that's actually not one I've heard before.
Mm-hmm.
Now here's a fun one. What's the most underrated salad dressing?
I say anything blue cheese.
Okay.
It's a love-hate relationship with blue cheese. I love blue cheese salad dressing.
So do I. I love blue cheese. Like if you have hot wings and blue cheese, like just blue cheese in general is so
blue
good.
Blue cheese wedge salad from the keg.
Yeah.
The blue cheese wedge from the keg. That's my favorite.
Nice. Who plays you in the movie of your life?
That's a great question. I've been told that Colin Farrell, I remind people of Colin Farrell. So,
I mean, I can see that, but do you think he can handle musically? That's the other part of it too. It's you have to juggle the two. Like I could see where the look part come from and everything with Colin Farrell makes some sense, but can he do you musically?
I don't know. I don't know if he has any music talent, but he kind of looks like a rock star. So I'm gonna give him the nod there.
Yeah, no, I mean, I could see where it would work. And it's your movie. You get to cast whoever you want, really.
Yeah, I'm giving him the nod there.
Okay. Now, we talked a bit last time about what you hope people take away from your music, but is there an overarching feeling that you want to just have everyone kind of absorb from what you're doing?
Yeah, joy and community, uplifting feeling. It wasn't like that with previous music that I've released. You know, it was a little bit more emotional, a little bit almost self-loathing to a certain extent. So it did not exude those emotions. But you know, I've really, really found a great feeling, I believe, with the music now. And I played a house party a couple weeks ago, and I remember, I'll toot my own horn a little bit on this. Just remember this upliftingness when we started playing music, and just how everybody went from kind of mingling in different areas of the party, and it just kind of brought everybody together into this unified section. And from after that moment on, it was just like we were one big family. And I really think that music has the power to do that. And I really want to leave that mark with my music.
So would you say that's your motivation for kind of keep walking down the music road?
100%. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think, you know, my motivation is threefold. Number one is to create a life for myself and my future family that, you know, I can do something and show my future family that you can do something you love and really make a life out of it. Number two, to create community and joy. And number three, to inspire others that are, you know, about to embark on this path and, you know, may need to see that you know, us Winnipeg boys can get it done, you know, small city, but just gotta put your head down and get to it.
100%. And we ended off the same way last time, but are you happy?
I'm happy. I like that question. I like it a lot because it does force you to think a little bit and reflect. And I'd say from last time we talked, I'm about a point or a point and a half higher out of 10 than last time. And you know, I really don't I wouldn't say it has anything to do with a change in stature in the music or any accolades. It's simply, like I said, accessing that within and just feeling a little bit more armored for life.
That makes sense, man. I feel that. So what's next for you? You have any fun festival stuff you were kind of briefly hinting at?
Well, festival seasons, you know, we've kind of gotten past our big festival spots for this year.
Okay.
The public performance side for the end of the year is a little bit quieter. We are going pretty hard on the project and recording a lot of material. 2025 is going to be a big run for festivals and the live show. But right now you can be expecting a lot of singles to come out, a lot more music, and which I think is the best thing as an audience, because you know then it's not confined to a single show or a single city. Like anybody can take it in. So we've got a lot of fun stuff coming up. I'm excited about this these next couple months.
I'm excited to hear it, man. Well, we're about to get cut off here, so we'll sign off and we'll keep in touch and do this again.
You bet. Thanks a lot, Tom.
All right, man. Have a good one.
Take care.